eternally there, living with life to eternity's end. 32 were there of their children, sons of the lights, who had come among men, seeking to free from the bondage of darkness, those who were bound by the force from beyond. So one of the things that he mentions there that's so fascinating is, well, many things, but one of them is the Halls of Amenti, okay? And right now we're seeing all these discoveries being made with all these tunnels under the pyramids of Giza, where some of these areas underneath, and these tunnels and these openings may be more extensive than even what's on the surface. That is something that people have to wrap their minds around, is that the surface may just be one of the places where a lot of these secrets lie, and most of them may actually be underground, because these beings are very smart. They know, and they look at Earth's history, that there have been so many cataclysms and destruction that have occurred that they can't risk losing everything on the surface. You know, you're not going to lose the Great Pyramids because they're so huge, and that's one of the reasons why he built them, besides energy. It was also to be a beacon for the future, but also if you build underground, you know that it'll be protected. It's in some ways forever. So one of the greatest discoveries that's going to be made in the future is going to lie in these tunnels underneath the Great Pyramids. Where
now, hasn't NASA taken over an aspect of the Giza Pyramid?
Have they what?
Now, haven't they taken over some aspect of the research at the Giza Pyramid?
Well, we just saw that a huge announcement just get made that I think everybody's been waiting for, where they discovered that there's electromagnetic energy that's been right. Perfectly tuned within the Great Pyramid of Giza, which everybody in our circle has been just waiting for, because we knew that. And that's simply just the component that is about harnessing the energy, because there's no writings or anything in the pyramids, and there's never been any pharaohs found in them. Those are all lies. They're simply massive energy power plants. But here's the question. What were they powering more than 10,000 years ago? And I think the answer to that has to do with two things: either connecting to the highest stage of energy that can be utilized for creation and affecting human energy, as well as potentially even changing the energy grids of the planet. Because these pyramids are built right on the ley lines in these special energy segments of our planet, which is simply just this sphere surrounded by electromagnetic energy. That's what everything is. That's why Tesla discovered free energy. He was simply just utilizing the electromagnetic energy of our planet that it creates. That's what these pyramids are. That's what all of these designs are all around the world, from ancient mounds you see out in Mexico in the Southwest, all the way to temple pyramids, and then all the way to these large pyramids. They in many ways had the same purposes, slightly different things at times, but overall they had the same purposes about energy. So Thoth from Atlantis says that these beings came from beyond, and they started using humans to incarnate into, and they would hide in them and pretend they were man and do all these, you know. It makes you think, if they were the ones responsible for new inventions and not just some random person tinkering, if you consider the fact that they mentioned how many times they keep incarnating and using people and using us for different means. And they call themselves the children of light. And they say that they were created when space, like back when everything was being formed from space time. And it's mind blowing. But it really echoes the idea that they may be millions of years old. And that's why we can't wrap our heads around how complex all of this is, because they're just so far beyond our capability of consciousness that we're just trying to pick up the scraps and pieces of all this without really understanding probably what the larger picture of all this is.
Right. I mean, there's so much. I mean, if you're just starting to get into this and discover these tablets and these old writings, it's so much to digest, and there's so much to cipher through. It's, you know, it's hard to tell the truth. But I mean, you know, with people like you getting all this excellent information out there, it's making it more abundant for people to understand what actually happened in our past.
Exactly. And take something like the Emerald Tablets. Again, more proof that you know they're not fake. Try to follow them. That's what I did. I took the teachings that were in there, and I said, I want to see, and the ancient cultures all around the world, like the Gnostics, I said to myself, it's not about just writing about this stuff. I want to see that this is why one of the reasons I'm so passionate is I've seen some of these higher states of energy by following this curriculum of how you can raise your vibration and all these different means. And when you do have these incredible experiences that go along with doing this, you are forever changed, and you know that it's real because you experience it directly. And, you know, walking outside in a higher state of energy and being so much more connected to your consciousness and all these other things, all of a sudden reality just becomes completely different, and your perspective on how you viewed everything changes. And a lot of your activities change, and what you used to do that was maybe just passing the time by then becomes doing things that actually create experiences and grow you. And that's why there's such a difference in between certain segments of society, because you have one segment that starts to learn about this stuff and just goes on, you know, the deepest rabbit hole ever and is considered crazy and a lunatic, because on the other side, some of society that's been given this mundane viewpoint, they look at some of this stuff without doing any of the studying or looking any of the history or the evidence, and it just looks crazy to them. And I would just like to bring up something that I bring up all the time, but it's just so important, is if you were around hundreds of years ago and you were told that there were giant lizards that were the size of buildings and houses running around all over the earth, stomping around, eating each other, these huge lizards, you would laugh your head off. I know I would. You would laugh your head off. And right. But what's amazing, though, is if you take that same group and then you bring them into a building and you start going, look at all these bones. You ever seen bones like this before? And you start putting them together to show this model of a skeleton of an enormous lizard. And all of a sudden, what became crazy is no longer crazy anymore. It simply seemed crazy because you didn't have the necessary information to be able to weigh and compare what you're looking at. And so all you have to do it's a hard road, but by going down the road of accumulating this knowledge and doing this, you're able to separate yourself out to know that there's all this stuff is existing. A lot of it's real. Some of it might not be. But a lot of it's real, and it's our job to find out what's real. Wouldn't you agree?
I would definitely agree, and that's exactly why I do this show, is to get the truth out there, or what could possibly be the truth about our history and everything that's going on that we don't know about.
Exactly. So I want to go into this next topic. It's one of these topics that, again, I brought up that dinosaur thing because we're going to be talking about giants and the Nephilim and fallen angels. And
now I wanted to say, before you get into this, I've been fascinated with the giant mythos, especially hear it in the Book of Enoch. It was removed from the Bible, probably for a very good reason. And I'd love to hear what you have to say about this. Go ahead.
Sure. So we're gonna have some discussions about this, and I want to bring some facts to the table, not just, again, like that evidence thing we were just talking about. Let's bring some facts to discuss this. Remember, we were talking about how the Anunna are very tall. You see that in a lot of places, right behind Chris on the wall there on his poster. That's the famous giant seated from Sumeria, where they have, you know, one of these great beings that's standing, you know, far above all the rest. That's simply a fact. They were much taller than we were, okay? That's, you can see that everywhere, all over these writings. They didn't simply represent their stature as greatness. You know, you make them larger than life because of that. It wasn't about that. They were very large. And we're going to get into evidence that proves that. Okay. And that's why if you look at the statues that have been created from a lot of those beings, they're almost all the same size. Think about that. Compare the facial sizes and how large these are. You'll find that all over the world, these statues of a lot of these are actually created with the same exact size, which is pretty amazing in itself. And you just opened it up mentioning the Book of Enoch. In the Book of Enoch, it goes into great detail about these fallen angels. And if you want to understand giants and the Nephilim, you have to first understand what fallen angels are, because they're directly connected in all of this. First of all, there's no such thing as angels, and there's no such thing as demons. It's just simply references to place something in a certain framework to understand it, okay? Because some of these angels are actually pretty bad beings. And some of those who we think are like Satan, the devil, and all these bad other beings are actually not bad at all, because the modern church ended up creating incredible confusion when they took all of these things that are not supposed to be literal, and they designed it in such a way where a lot of people are so confused because of it, because of what they've done about the whole heaven and hell thing. Heaven is simply higher dimensions. Hell is simply lower states of energy where energy is managed and manipulated. That's what essentially it is. And the underworld, which is considered the same as hell, is not a bad place at all. It's simply, again, it represents where energy is managed. Okay. These terms
confuse us.
Yeah. These terms have been incredibly perverted. And that means taking their true meanings and not only inverting them, but making them, turning one into like a demonic term that has nothing to do with it. Take an example of, before I get going, continue on this, take an example of Satan. Satan, this figure, has this pitchfork, right? And this, at the same time, if you look at the trident carried by all kinds of references showing what most likely is probably Enki, Ea, and showing Poseidon with his trident, right, you see very quickly that the pitchfork is simply the inverted version of the trident. That's it. That's all it is. And that's why all of this stuff has been manipulated so much. So the Book of Enoch, which is one of the most important Gnostic set of writings ever written, along with like the Nag Hammadi scriptures, was just very cleverly written out of the modern Bible because of what it contained. It talked about these fallen angels. It talked about, you know, the Nephilim. What are those terms? Well, fallen angels, what it means is if these beings, these Anuna beings, these Anunnaki beings exist in higher dimensions, and they're these higher dimensional beings, they're more advanced. What the term fallen means is if they did something very wrong, they were cast down and they were no longer immortal, essentially like eternal, and they were forced down into our reality, and they had to live out either existing here in this reality, this realm, or they had to live out being an actual physical being that could die. And so the term fallen angels means that they were cast down to the physical realm of Earth, and some of them were forced to remain here, and they ended up causing chaos because of it. Okay. And so what that means is one of the most common reason why they'd be called fallen angels is that they would come down. Some of them would come down and end up having promiscuous acts with females, because female women are beautiful. That's not just my perspective. They are, they're beautiful. And they attracted some of these beings who, you know, look at how Enlil views the human race. He called us beasts who never deserved these divine genetic gifts that were given to us. So if you have that mentality held by some of them, where they don't think that we ever should have had this given to us in the first place, that's one of the things that justifies their reasoning by keeping us in a lower state of energy, because they don't think we deserve it. So if you have that mentality and you have some of these beings that mate with mortal women, was seen as an incredibly despicable act. And so that they were then kicked out from this realm, this higher dimensional conscious place that they exist in, and they were forced into our realm to stay here eternally. Okay. Now, and that's why we have these terms with, you know, the Michael, these archangels and all these different things in all throughout religion. Okay. Now, what is the Nephilim? The Nephilim means any of these fallen angels, these Anunnaki were cast down for having promiscuous acts with mortal women. Any of those women who gave birth to a child who was directly crossed with these genetics, those were the Nephilim. Now, because here's the evidence. Because if you look at all the evidence, we're going to go over all this stuff that mentions the Nephilim and the evidence for giants in history. They're even shorter than the Anunnaki, because they're only half the Anunnaki, okay? That's why in the Sumerian king list, the reason why we have so many kings that were so tall and lived so long was because they were literally direct crosses of these bloodlines in these Anunnaki branches, okay? And that's the same thing that continued all throughout reality. Some of them that were in charge especially some of the negative polarity aspects of it.